So today I'm going to talk, about, there's a rising epidemic that has swept the world and the nation, which is the epidemic of opiate abuse. And even if you guys don't have any like family members that are dealing with the issue, I'm sure that you guys know someone or probably heard someone who has dealt with the issue. Dr. Nora Valka represented in front of the Senate caucus on international narcotics control and stated that between 26.4 and 36 million people worldwide are abusers of opiate. And it was estimated that 2.1 in the US million were suffering from substance abuse disorders that were related to prescription pain relievers in 2012, and also about 467,000 that were addicted to heroin. This is clearly an issue that not only affects individuals, but the national economy, like that kind of stuff. So now I'm going to talk about three points, which are the problem, which is opiate abuse, and some of the causes and the effects. So the problem, it all started around 3400 BC. Opium derives from the poppy plant, which was cultivated in lower Mesopotamia. The Sumerians called it the Hulgil, which means a joy plant for obvious reasons. Then it was passed down to the Assyrians and then the Egyptians, and it eventually made its way down to the U.S., especially during the Gold Rush, Fast forward like 100 years, it's in a bunch of medicine that we use. And the fact that in recent years, it's in a lot of prescription medication really allows for people to use it non-medically, which, again, skyrockets the broad issue of drug abuse. So according to the Center for Behavioral Health Studies and Quality, non-medical prescription pain reliever use is a major public health problem that has resulted in increasing numbers of emergency department visits, treatment, admissions, and fatal overdoses. So back to what I said, it's a huge problem. So now I'm going to talk some of, talk about some of the causes. So there are, you know, like there's externals, like causes, like social and individual environment that contribute to the development of one's own drug abuse. But there's also the brain's response to opiates, which shows how the addiction starts on a fundamental level. So as you can see, the chemicals in opiates attach to proteins called new opiate receptors that are kind of like all over your brain. And according to Thomas Barbacostin and Tony P. George, both medical doctors, in an article written in 2002, when drugs stimulate new opioid receptors in the brain, cells in the ventral tegmental area produce dopamine and release it into the nucleus accumbens, giving rise to feelings of pleasure. So that mesolimbic reward system is that same one that produces dopamine when you have like sex or eat good food and stuff like that. And repeated exposure to escalated doses of this causes the brain to function normally when the drug is not present and abnormally when it is, when it's not. So basically, the areas of the brain that are responsible for blood pressure and respiration are heavily suppressed while you use these drugs, in the body. And so when you use it gradually over time, your body begins to adjust, and those same areas begin to heighten in activity to stabilize the body, so that when you're not on the drug, they're still functioning in that state, and your body kind of goes that way. So the other causes, is the, I guess, accessibility. There's a lot of pain clinics in the US that are prescribing these medications at an alarming rate, narcotics. About 5 years ago, Florida, for example, had the highest prescription rate in the entire world, mainly because it lacked an official online data registry for the prescriptions, which pretty much gave medical practitioners an incentive to be bought out by drug dealers or just to prescribe medication to people who had pain or injuries just because they didn't want to look into them. So basically, those doctors got lazy or they got corrupted, and a lot of them went to jail for it, but you know, despite the DEA's ongoing investigation, the prescription rate in the US is still pretty high because a lot of states saw that and they realized, you know, it's not hard to come across it. So now I'm going to talk about some of the effects. If you've ever heard the idea that marijuana is a gateway drug, it's kind of the same concept, only it's probably true. around 2010 when the FDA called for the reformation of those prescription drugs, centers began to monitor and study the relationship between those new drugs and stronger drugs. So, So according to the street price data from Rocky Mountain Poison Control Center, Drug Diversion Monitoring Program indicated that the demand for the new formulation was much lower than that for the old formulation, which was more powerful and produced highs similar to those produced by heroin. Data from the National Survey on Drug Abuse and Health over the course of 10 years indicates that it's no coincidence that when the drugs became less stronger, the use and abuse of heroin rose. you can see it really does become a gateway drug, like really. And the other effects are withdrawal. I think I'm running out of time, so I'm just going to get to it. They last between up to a month, and between that and a week. And your body isn't really in any danger when you're going through withdrawal, but it's more of like a psychological toll that post-acute withdrawal does. But yeah, it includes low energy, irritability, anxiety, runny nose, hot and cold sweats, muscle aches, pains, nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. And they can last up to about 2 years. So those are the effects. And so I've talked about those 3 points, the problem, some of the causes and the effects. And it's important to know because it can help you prevent it from affecting you later on in life. And you gotta keep in mind that some of you are gonna have to use like pain relievers at some point in your lives. And that's kind of just how it starts, you know? So you just gotta learn to be responsible.